You know, you break down this book and you mentioned, you know, Under the Hood or Black Freighter. These are all things that Zach has fought tooth and nail to have be part of this thing.
I'm just bowled over by the level of attention to detail. I mean, every little corner of everything is being considered.
You have to go back to the past to understand the future because it gives it its footing.
The depth and detail of the graphic novel is one of the reasons that people really enjoy it. And we wanted to provide an analogous experience for a moviegoer.
You need to understand what the Watchmen world is. And to do that, you need those bits of media that help define the culture.
The beautiful thing about bringing Watchmen to the screen now is we're able to present Black Freighter and Under the Hood, separate and apart from the movie and ultimately brought together within the main text of the movie.
Part of what's so compelling about Watchmen is that it wasn't just telling the story of these characters, it was the story of our world. And the people that created it literally said, okay, our world has comic books, our world has media culture, so if we introduce this one little idea that superheroes are real, what does that do to the rest of the world? And so when you take the media culture, hey, there would be some hero that writes an autobiography and, you know, and talks about it, just like our celebrities do. And there would be a whole other cultural medium. If superheroes are real, then what does that mean to the things that generate the superhero idea? It's kind of feeding in on itself.
The more you set it in a real world and then have real world publications reflecting on events, and then you have comic books within the comic book, everything is a counterpoint to something else, everything comments on something else, everything enriches and underscores the main story.
Under the Hood and Tales of the Black Freighter fit perfectly as a piece of the puzzle into this worldview that the creators of the book were envisioning.
One of the happy coincidences in making the original Watchmen was that we made the decision not to include ads because the work was so unusual in its scope. But we made it late enough in the process that rather than the stories being designed to fully fill out the book, there was a little bit of space left at the back, which would have constituted the advertising section.
And I said, why don't we simply use those pages to flesh out the story?
And the creators and the DC editorial staff together collaborated on doing a variety of side pieces that were evocative of the world the Watchmen lived in.
You know, Alan had talked about Under the Hood, Alan had talked about a lot of the other elements that sort of helped make the world. Let's show some of that. Let's show a few chapters of Under the Hood. Let's find out about the world of the pirate comics. Let's deepen the story and give people backstory that they don't need to read to appreciate the actual Watchmen novel, but we'll give them a whole lot of different levels of appreciation if they follow the stuff through. So Alan started writing Under the Hood, which is his story about what it was like to be one of the first superheroes back in the 40s, and how he became a hero and how he ultimately decided to stop being one.
Under the Hood is a very important part of Watchmen. And, you know, first of all, it does something which really had rarely been seen in comics before. Comics are a visual medium, right? All of a sudden we're given like 2 pages of single-spaced, tight prose.
It wasn't just a text piece. We wanted to produce the world that these people lived in. So rather than just running text about what would be in a newspaper, we created a newspaper. The logo, the front of it, all the little things would be on it, coffee stains on it, whatever it was to help the verisimilitude that this was a real world that these people lived in.
You know, imagining the back history of Watchmen was a lot of fun. And also it was a lot of fun because you only had to glimpse it. You didn't have to draw whole continuities that took place in the 1930s. And sometimes a glimpse is much more evocative, implying that there's as much detail back there as you can see now.
Having this text-based narrative within the story, it's almost a precursor or a predictor to the internet. If you're reading a comic or reading a story or reading even a news item on the internet, you have all these hyperlinks. Oh, want to know more about this? Read this guy's diary or go to his MySpace page. It's the story behind the story or commentary on a story, but instead of it being in the back of the book or pretending to be somebody's diary interspersed with the book, suddenly it's on the DVD or online. And so Watchmen, in a way, really took a very sophisticated and advanced look at what entertainment could be.
After he gives up superheroing, he becomes a mechanic, and he's always looking under the hood. But in superhero terms, when you're looking under the hood of a costumed character, then of course you're really taking off the mask and looking beneath the mask to see really how that person functions, just as you look to see how does an engine function.
Under the hood is such an integral part to understanding the depth of the individuals that were part of this masked vigilante movement.
It gives us an insight into who Hollis Mason is and his relationship to the other characters.
The original costumed heroes in that world got into it for all kinds of different reasons, but it had never been done before. So they were all trying it out for the first time. And very few people who put on the costume ever come to a happy end.
Being a superhero wasn't necessarily so super.
You may think you put on a mask to do good things, but you find you're kind of on the outside and you have a power and you start acting like what you hate, which is kind of what happens to them.
Hollis is the one that emerges relatively unscathed from that initial group to the point where his exploits and his reputation is enough to inspire the next generation.
Just as those of us who grow up reading comics now have our own fantasies and heroes and idols, so was Dan Dreiberg as a young boy fascinated by the adventures of Hollis Mason as Night Owl.
Dan had written Hollis, and Hollis sort of became his mentor. And he asked if he could carry on the name.
In many ways, Under the Hood is a prologue to Watchmen. It brings us up into the present day. We understand how the first group of superheroes got started, how they inspired other superheroes in their wake, and those other superheroes they inspired are the ones that we meet in Watchmen.
Under the Hood sets the stage for the worldview in Watchmen of what heroes are and how they evolve and the idea of the escalation.
His memoir has a gee whiz quality to it, a sort of naive innocence, even as he writes it as an infinitely older man and looks back at his life.
Clearly, the book is intended to be something that depicts a more innocent time that slowly degenerates into something that's a little more sinister and dangerous. All of a sudden, the world's a much, much bigger, much more terrifying place.
Coming to New York at 12 years old, it was fantastic for me in a lot of ways.
Something that Hollis Mason is getting across is a sense of his own romantic notion of why he chose to don a costume and fight crime. It's something that's very much rooted in the rural values, the old world values that were handed down to him by his father and his grandfather that he's trying to reconcile in this modern urban environment. He becomes a cop. It's not enough. He takes it to this next step.
I think his greatest motivation was that it was going to be like being a kid again.
To fight for justice and to fight for your ability to be able to handle things on your own.
Through the experience of being around the comedian, Dollar Bill, Captain Metropolis, Sally Jupiter, etc., he starts to figure out that maybe everybody's got their own reason, and those reasons aren't necessarily his reasons.
You know, it's one thing for a cop in a costume to sort of beat up thugs in the street, but then what happens when we get Dr. Manhattan? All of a sudden, the level of villain has to rise to match the level of the hero.
I think I can boil the feeling down to three words, really. It's we've been replaced. And I don't just mean the masked adventurers, I mean humanity.
What Under the Hood offered was kind of a step backwards, seen through the eyes of one of the previous generations of superheroes, and how that all evolved.
That's awesome. Well, I got the line out. Here's something. Do we do it again?
Yeah.
The amount of time and resources spent on doing everything possible we can to stick to this book, I find amazing. And Under the Hood is another thing. It's an important part of this whole process.
I feel like I should say Merry Christmas.
That's it.
Under the Hood exists as a best-selling memoir, and the world would respond to that tell-all memoir in the same way that our world responds. They'd be on TV.
Under the Hood is a fantastic book.
A talk show or a news magazine show. So we created a hard-hitting magazine-style news show, the type of thing that would have existed in that time period. And that's how we came to make Under the Hood into video form.
I'm Larry Culpepper for the Culpepper Minute. The comedian declined to comment.
I had a blast personally shooting it because I just got to be the comedian, which, you know, go ahead and ask the comedian a question in character and see what happens, and we know what happens. It's never a good outcome.
Was that thing with any good? You know what I mean?
Well, it was interesting working with the cast, be it the comedian in his brief cameo, or Bernard, the news vendor, or Carla Gugino playing Sally Jupiter, or even Hollis. They all knew the backstory of their character because Zach had kind of prepped them so well.
To me, that's like a dream. When I got all of that source material and all of the sort of commentary on the source material, it was incredibly helpful for me.
They were able to improvise when we were conducting our interviews, and improvisation allowed us to really sink into what this memoir meant. I think it is important, though, that we wanted to keep some of the language from the original text. So in Hollis's case, a lot of Stephen McCaddy's dialogue is actually straight from the original wording of Under the Hood.
These characters have escaped from their four-color world, and they were now in the factual, black-and-white world of the headlines.
Every newsstand has the kid who's there every Wednesday when the books come in, waiting for the new issue of his favorite book. When I was a kid, I was that kid. Most of my friends were that kid. There is that kid in the Watchmen film, and so he introduces us to it.
It's definitely one of the types of books you have to like read a few times before you can actually get what's going on.
Black Freighter was heavy, man. When I first read it, I was just like, damn, scratching my head a little bit. The second time I started to really get it, understood the point of it a little bit more, and then it became more clear.
You're forced to say, well, it's here. It's part of the fabric of the story. So as a reader, you have to reconcile and say, well, okay, why is it here?
The thing that I was kind of interested in was the day-to-day feeling of society. You know, things like fast foods, things like reading material. The whole thing about the pirate comics and the whole Black Freighter thread was that I remember thinking, probably they wouldn't read superhero comics in a world where there really were superheroes. So what else would be as kind of exciting and colorful and swashbuckling? And I thought, oh, pirates, yeah, they could have pirate comics. So I put that down in one of these lists, pirate comics, and of course, Alan took it and turned it into a whole kind of subtext and a whole allegory for what was happening. We always wanted the Black Freighter comic to feel different than the world of Watchmen, although they're both kind of drawn by the same person and written by the same person. The panel layouts that I would do in the Black Freighter things were much more dynamic and much more exciting in some way, you know, much more visceral. And again, yeah, to differentiate it, the different color palette helped.
What we were trying to do was to try and show the crudity of cheap comics within the context of the Watchmen world. So the only way we could actually do that in those days was actually make the colors even more garish and gross.
It wasn't until we actually came to do the Absolute Watchmen, which is the big oversized one, that we were able to do that thing with the dot patterns.
It's supposed to be a comic book of its time. The technology is not there, and the comic book has a more blatant dot pattern than the real world does.
A lot of old comic books, the dot pattern was very obvious. It was a thing of making it feel different to the regular narrative of Watchmen, while still not making it just jump out as being completely out of place, you know?
And then there's the idea of the panels of Black Freighter, in which we only sort of see the written word, you know, laid over panels of Watchmen. So it's kind of this bleed effect. You know, you kind of are in the Watchmen world, then you follow the kid who's reading the comic by the newsstand into the Black Freighter world, and then you kind of are brought out of it. And often, sometimes in the books, it's not even that clear. You're right in the middle of the Watchmen story, and then all of a sudden the voiceover essentially comes over, but it's the Black Freighter stuff.
Of course, you know, the Black Freighter. I remember, you know, hearing the original Black Freighter on the ship, the Black Freighter. That's what it struck me right at the beginning. Brecht, Bertolt Brecht.
The title, The Black Freighter, was taken from the Brecht and Weill three-penny opera. Pirate Jenny sings a song about the Black Freighter, and it's kind of, based on my limited knowledge, sort of an image of death. When the Black Freighter comes for you, it's probably not a good thing, you know, right?
Alan's very fond of the works of Kurt Weill, and that was, you know, that was something that he thought would be a good basis for a pirate comic, rather than just make it any pirate comic.
When we have excerpts from Rorschach's diary, he talks about how all the whores and the politicians will look up and shout, "Save me," and he'll look down and whisper, "No." And although those are not the exact lyrics from Pirate Jenny, they are very, very close in spirit to the lyrics of the song. I think the allusion to the Black Freighter and Pirate Jenny and Brecht is just one of the more obvious allusions, and there are a myriad of allusions that can be found in Watchmen, and some probably that it will take us years to recognize.
A Black Freighter works in the graphic novel, I think, on a number of different levels.
It is a mirror of the original story and a parallel all at the same time. Well, it's essentially one man's quest to survive and to get home to his family, and the fact that it doesn't necessarily work out the way you want it to. I mean, there's a lesson to be taught right there. Things don't really work out the way they were all planned to work out in The Watchmen.
Ultimately, in this quest to be a savior, he actually becomes a monster himself.
It kind of follows Adrian's story, doesn't it, in more ways than one?
The Watchmen story itself is about a would-be savior, as is the Black Freighter pirate story. Adrian Veidt, also known as Ozymandias, has a plan to, he believes, save the world. I think the Black Freighter is an interesting allegory of Veidt's journey, but whereas the morality tale of the Black Freighter is quite clear, the morality questions that are raised by Veidt's actions are much more ambiguous. And I think, as with any great work of art, rather than spelling everything out for the reader, Watchmen raises all these questions and provokes dialogue.
It's somebody who's looking so closely at a situation or a thought or an idea with tunnel vision that they miss the point. And so when he actually goes back home, he's so enraged by his thoughts that he can't see clearly. And so he kills innocent people and he destroys everything that he thinks he's standing up to protect or you know, persevering to protect. We all have a tendency to get so focused on what we're about that we miss a lot of reality. If this guy was able to see a little bit more clearly, he would have understood that this had nothing to do with anybody else other than his own soul.
It's designed that you can take away what you need to take away from it. I mean, any good story allows you to interpret what you want to interpret from it, or need to interpret from it.
You know, be careful of who wants to save you.
people's desire to do the right thing, but also what comes along with that kind of altruism, what comes along with that is there's always a darkness to it. Really, you see that in all of the characters.
It seems like, you know, Alan Moore and Gibbons conceived of Black Freighter to serve a multitude of purposes, whether it's telling Adrian Veidt's story, whether it's reflecting on Rorschach's capture, whether it's just depicting the basic idea that pirate comics are the big genre. It's existentialist, it's postmodern, it's comments on itself, all while being this separate and yet integral part of the entire piece.
Zach decided that for a DVD release separately and also for the director's cut that he wanted to actually make this movie and include it into the greater movie of The Watchmen.
It's going to be there as an animated sequence, jumping in and out of live action and animation.
While we're on the backlot, shot all of the ins and outs with Bernard the news vendor and Bernard the kid.
For us, it was just a matter of making the little bridges that went from the main flow of the script was to the Black Freighter story.
It's a very logical way to go through into these drawn frames, particularly in a film context, and then go into something that brings those drawings to life and remains in animation.
Zach drew the storyboards, and those sort of went on to have some backgrounds designed, and then those all went off to our animation company, Big Star, in Seoul, South Korea, where there are a large crew of really nice people drawing this story frame by frame on pieces of paper with pencils, no computers, frame by frame with pencils, and then it gets the ink and paint treatment in Korea, and then it comes back to a place called Real Effects in Texas for final compositing and putting it together.
Are contented.
This is Jerry Butler, and he's really great. I mean, he is truly the anguished captain of his ship. So it's a really sort of tragic tale of this guy's descent into madness. And it'll stand up by itself as an interesting little short film.
I was a horror. Amongst horrors must I dwell.
Give me a little more of him reading and looking.
If you ever look to adapt Watchmen, the first thing anyone does is, well, you gotta lose Black Freighter because it's not specifically germane to the story. And for Zach to say, no, wait a minute. Black Freighter is just as important an element of Watchmen as Dr. Manhattan, as Veidt, as the interaction of these characters, as the time period. And to do it in this way, I think it actually amplifies one of the central ideas in terms of how one is to perceive Watchmen.
Watchmen, the graphic novel, is always going to be there. It was all of our job to try to create the analogous movie-going experience. So in handling the supporting material as a Black Freighter anime or an Under the Hood documentary finds the perfect tone for making Watchmen a movie experience.
So if you go and see the Watchmen movie, and then you go get Under the Hood and the Black Freighter, and then you go and you look at those, and then all of a sudden that informs how you see the movie, and you go back and look at the movie again, and then something you see in the movie tells you, oh, I better look at Black Freighter again, then that's exactly how the guys wanted you to experience the comic book in the first place.
Is the comedian, as Hollis' book implies, Laurie's true father?
I think you've gotten all you need. It's very nice to chat with you. Yes.
Thank you.
That's it for me.
We can stop.
Mm-hmm.